morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. My name is Donald Charles Schwartz, and I represent the plaintiff appellant in this action. And preliminarily, I would like to say that my client, contrary to the ad hominem attack in the brief, has enjoyed a stellar career in the entertainment industry. He's worked with the likes of Clive Davis, Don Kirshner, Jeff Berry, Tom Jones on the She's a Lady album. He's written all of the Archie Funhouse TV songs, including the first pro-ecology song for children played on national TV, a song entitled Mr. Factory, played by the Archies, and has written for...
Counselor, frankly, I don't care about ad hominem attacks. I think your client's a wonderful person. I'm not worried about that. What's worrying me is why the district court denied, or why you think the district court improperly denied the motion to remand.
Well, I think the pink elephant in the room, so to speak, is that the federal trial court completely ignored it.
Hold on just a minute. If I read Sparta, which is a case you cite, it says the operative pleading controls the removal. When the pleadings were in front of the court on the removal, there was only one pleading, and it contained an express copyright infringement claim, which was automatically something that the federal court ought to take.
Well, technically, there was a First Amendment complaint.
Well, technically, there was not a First Amendment complaint because nobody filed, nobody served any copy of it any place.
Okay. Well, in the trial court record was a state court order dismissing the first cause of action.
Hold on just a minute. Again, I don't think that dismissal had any effect either because it had never been served.
Okay. If this court is going to rely on the interpretation of...
I'm not relying on any interpretation at all. I'm relying on, if I'm talking about the amendment, I'm talking about Cal Civil Code Procedure 472. If I'm talking about the dismissal, I'm talking about the Cal Rules of Court 3.1390. If I'm looking at the federal law, I'm looking at 28 U.S.C. 1446A. Every one of those suggests that if you're not going to serve anybody, then I don't have any right to take it into consideration.
Okay. The court order, the state court order, which longstanding U.S. Supreme Court and Ninth Circuit rulings have held, that the federal court takes the state court case as it is when it appears.
Well, I understand that. As it is, as it appears, was it had an infringement claim. It had no amended claim because it was never served. It had the copyright infringement claim. It had no dismissal because it wasn't served. And now here I am, still in the same boat.
Okay. Well, no state court or federal court before or since has interpreted any of the California state law, including the Rules of Court 3.1390, to mean that if a dismissal of a cause of action of a party or of the entire complaint is not served on all defendants, that it is not then operative. If that is going to be the ruling here, then I can assure the court that there are millions of cases lurking in state court files, California state court files, ready to spring to life because dismissals were not served on the defendant.
Just a second. I guess I'd have to find all this rule that you say I'm bending because it seems to me from your argument you're agreeing that you hadn't served the defendants with either the amended complaint or the dismissal, correct?
They had not appeared in the action yet, and they appeared in the action within 2 weeks.
Did you serve on any of them?
They were served after the case was removed.
So then if it's after removed, then I guess I'm trying to figure out how your case law, either Jenkins or Sparta or Williams,
goes through federal court, takes the state court case as it sits. And the
what case are you really citing here for that?
Well,
Sparta is pretty straight. The operative pleading controls removal. Post-removal amendments do not affect the removal analysis. Williams says post-removal amendments cannot affect when the case is removable. Jenkins says extension of time request in the lower court is still pending in the federal court. So if you'd had an extension of time, you'd have been able to do something, but we didn't find that. I'm looking at all these cases, and I'm having a tough time understanding where you're going to take me.
Well, the state court ordered that the first cause of action for federal copyright claims was dismissed. It ordered that all federal claims are dismissed. Within 2 weeks of that order, the case was removed. Then it was served.
Mr. Schwartz, the state court ordered the removal of that cause of action after the case had been removed.
That's not correct. The state court ordered the request for dismissal that's in the our request for judicial notice. The state court ordered the first cause of action and the all federal causes of action dismissed from the case before it was removed. The federal trial judge here did not address that at all. He skipped over it.
What case says that post-service actions by the plaintiff without notice to the defendants are relevant?
There is no case one way or the other.
Just a minute. I agree. I disagree with that. Harris versus Banker Life and Casualty, 2005 case from our court, says the notice of removability under 1446B is determined through examination of the four corners of the applicable pleadings, not through subjective knowledge or a duty to make further inquiry. So if I look at those that are applicable, not the dismissal is not applicable, not served. The amendment is not applicable, not served. So Harris says dead on.
The inquiry cases refer to factual inquiry, not the status of the case as a matter of law as it sits in the state court. As a matter of law, this.
What's your best case for this?
Well, the best case would be the Jenkins.
The Jenkins case on an extension of time?
Well, the language of Granny Goose, referring to Duncan v. Gagan, of course.
I'm trying to get your best case.
Would be in Jenkins at page 195.
Okay.
The longstanding principle is that the federal court takes the case.
Is that a 95 Fed Third 791?
95 Fed Third 791 at page.
Oh, why is it at 195?
Page 195.
It can't be if it starts at 791.
Correct. It starts with 791 and at page 795.
Oh, 795, not 195.
Excuse me. States that the long, going back to the 1880s, the longstanding rule as recognized by this court and the U.S. Supreme Court is that this federal court takes the state court case where the state court left off. The state court in this case ordered the federal copyright claim dismissed and all federal causes of action.
Okay. The way of assuming that we do get to the complaint from the res judicata effect of the dismissal of the first action?
Well, you don't get to the res judicata motion unless you get past the predicate motion to dismiss or jurisdictional issue. This case is based entirely on new facts. As pleaded, the defendants here, arguably in collaboration with
the facts, simply because you changed copyright infringement to a new allegation of the same actions.
The California law provides for the in the entertainment industry an implied contract, which is what this case solely is about, a state court implied contract case.
What I'm asking you to focus on, sir, isn't the gravamen of the complaint still the version of copyrighted materials?
No, the gravamen of this complaint is the violation of an implied contract under California law and protection, specifically in California and protection.
That's a new theory based on the same facts which were tried in the first action.
No, there's an entirely new set of facts which involves a specific excision of a thumbprint scenario of a televised version of the Terminator movie, where they took out a scene involving the existence or non-existence of music on Earth, which was one of the subplots within my client's materials, as is the televised version. They took that out, and then when my client started inquiring about it, they put it back in 30 days later in the televised version. It's very suspicious. That was the focal point of the facts leading up to this, that to the extent that it was a very unusual fact in the face of the monster Terminator concept, that music was missing or had been eliminated from the human species. A very unusual subplot, which was in the original Terminator. Then they removed it after all the litigation. Then, after my client inquired about it, they put it back in, and that was the last act in the conspiracy, which re-triggered all the state statutes.
Wasn't the same conspiracy, except you have a further act after the adjudication?
There's no, it wasn't really a conspiracy. It was the previous litigate. By the way, in the first case, there's no res judicata effect because the same federal trial judge is here throughout, despite assurances to my client that if he hired an attorney, he could be allowed to introduce all his expert evidence. The judge threw out all the expert evidence, then ruled on the summary judgment motion. Therefore, there cannot be a res judicata effect because all the evidence was not heard. The second case...
Res judicata turns on whether there's a final and valid judgment. Wasn't there a final and valid judgment in the first case, regardless of how it was arrived at?
Well, I would have to say I wouldn't call it valid because...
Did you appeal?
It was appealed, and this court rejected the appeal because there was a claim that it was 150 words or something over the word numerosity limit, and that therefore invoked an inquiry as to what is a word versus what is a number. And this court apparently, through the clerk's office...
I'm sorry, I have to interrupt you, but you're way over your time. And we've taken you there by our questioning, but we do have to follow the calendar, so thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Please, the court. I'm Charles Shepard for defendant James Cameron, and I'm going to be splitting my time with my co-counsel who represents me.
Of the issue of whether service was required.
That'll be my issue, Your Honor.
Let me ask you something. If the California court dismissed the action, regardless whether the service of the request for dismissal was served on your opponent, and if that order were entered, isn't that a ruling by a California court that service is not really required?
I don't believe so, Your Honor. First of all, California Rule of Court 3.1390 provides expressly that requests for dismissals or orders of dismissal must be served on the other
party. But the California Superior Court entered an order of dismissal of the case without an affidavit of proof of service on you, on your client. So it may be an error by the California Superior Court, which was not appealed as a final judgment. Isn't that a ruling that the California courts do not interpret this rule of court as requiring service?
I can't comment on that. All I know is that we, for purposes of analyzing removal, we have to look at what was served on the parties. That's clear from the federal removal statute itself. If you look at the removal statute, 1446A, 28 U.S.C., section 1446A, it says a notice of removal must reference all process, pleading, and orders served upon the defendants. That suggests that when you're looking at the propriety of removal, you have to look at what the defendants have before them, what they received.
That's
consistent, I think, with what the court said in Harris versus Banker's Life, which is what Judge Smith referenced, which is that there's no duty of inquiry. And if you look at the...
If we get past that issue, can we really say that the gravamen of this state complaint is still a conversion of the copyrighted materials?
Yes. And, well, candidly, I was going to have my co-colleague address that issue.
Talk about that.
Yes, although, simply put, and I'm not going to steal too much of his thunder, but it's basically pled as a conversion claim. And basically what the amended complaint says, the so-called state court claims, the implied contract claims, basically says, you converted my materials.
Then by volition, then, your argument is that we is controlled by federal law, not by state law, regardless of what happened in the state.
Well, what our position is this, that the case was properly removed.
Under federal law?
Under federal law, of course, based upon the existence of the express copyright claim, which, of course, the federal court has exclusive jurisdiction. If you accept the argument which the plaintiffs posit, that you should disregard the express copyright claim, our secondary argument is, in an alternative argument, and one you don't even have to reach, what my colleague is going to address, is that the remaining claim, exclude express copyright, the remaining claim is really just a disguised copyright claim. It can't really be an implied contract claim under California law.
He calls it a breach of implied contract.
Excuse me?
He calls it a breach of implied contract.
That's what he calls it, but you don't look at it.
You're not going to argue that case. Why don't we hear from the person who's going to argue it?
Okay, on that particular issue, I will. But just on the removal issue, I just want to really echo what I think Judge Smith said, that you look to, under California law and federal law, what was served.
I think we're pretty well informed.
Okay, I'm going to defer to my colleague who's going to address some of the other issues that Your Honors have raised. Before I do so, I do just want to make one preliminary and no longer.
Sorry, he's not going to be mad. You're stealing his time.
We've got a great relationship, Your Honor. But I do think it's important to recognize that the copyright claim and the implied contract claim were already adjudicated adverse to this plaintiff. At several points in his brief, he says the implied contract claim was never adjudicated. That's flat out wrong. It was. It was dismissed on a 12B6 motion early on in the case. These claims have already been adjudicated. In fact, Judge White, when he granted us attorney's fees in the first action, called the claims frivolous. And I'll defer to my colleague then.
Thank you very much.
I'm Bruce Isaacs of Davis Wright Tremaine. I represent Gail Ann Hurd. Just to jump right to it is, I agree with Mr. Shepard's position on the removal issues. My point was that even if you looked at the unserved First Amended complaint as the operative pleading, which I don't think you should do, but even if you did that, that complaint, you have to look at the substance of the complaint, not what it's called, not what it's labeled. And it's just chocked through and through with allegations of conversion of intellectual property. And we cited this case called Zito in our brief. And Zito, ironically, was a Judge White decision. And in that case, he ruled that the substance of an allegation alleging that intellectual property was converted is in essence a copyright claim. So the point is that even if you look at this First Amended complaint as the operative complaint, removal would have been proper and res judicata would apply. And the two real quick points.
Well, we're really talking about, in order for res judicata to apply, we have to have an identity of the the claims, a final judgment on the merits and privity, and it seems to me the only thing we're really talking here is the identity of the claims, right?
Yes, but let me just...
Because he kind of... there was a final judgment on the merits. There is a privity between the parties. So I guess we're really talking about identity.
So let me talk about identity real quick, and let me just echo what Mr. Shepard said, because it's 100% true. It is not correct for anybody to stand up here and say, hey, this is a new theory. This is a breach of implied in fact contract case. This is a Desney versus Wilder case. It never was before. It was a Desney versus Wilder case. It was an idea submission case.
Well,
back in 2005.
Sorry, I'm really getting to without interrupting too much. If I read identity of the claims and our case law or precedent about that, that identity of claims is when multiple claims arising out of or involving the same claim or cause of action are the same identity claims if they arise out of the same transactional nucleus of facts, right?
Correct, and it's the same.
It seems to me that's what we have to concentrate on. Are they the same transactional nucleus, right?
Yes, and it is the same nucleus of facts. It's the same story we've been hearing since 2005.
But there was one difference, wasn't there, in this new complaint, in that he alleges that there were changes in the television version of Terminator Salvation.
First of all, that was alleged before in the first case, and it was briefed in the summary judgments. But the issue has always been confusing to us because, as we understand it, what he's saying is the new fact is that they somehow edited a television show. I don't even know if that's true, by the way, and made it less like his alleged work and therefore further from an alleged copyright infringement or an idea submission claim.
Well, did the district judge make any finding concerning that issue?
I don't recall him. He made a lot of findings, and I just want to, not specific on that point, as I recall, but I want to just say, Judge White was incredibly patient and careful. This case was not a default or anything. There was a First Amendment complaint, a Second Amendment complaint, a Third Amendment complaint. There were summary judgment motions. There were motions to dismiss. There were expert testimony. He gave Mr. Goldberg every opportunity to litigate his case fully, and we ultimately prevailed. And it's 12 years. And the whole point of the same operative set of facts and the whole point of res judicata is at some point we have to be done. At some point there has to be closure, there has to be finality, there has to be certainty where the system, quite frankly, breaks down, and we're way past that point.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Honors.
Answered the question which was asked by our colleague on the right.
Honorable Brian.
I'm sorry. Yes, thank you. In the proceedings below, a claim for implied contract was submitted, and Judge White expressly addressed that claim, and he ruled that in a claim for breach of implied contract, the statute of limitations runs from the time that the work that is allegedly infringing is first presented to the public. So with respect to Terminator 1, the breach of implied contract claim ran 2 years after the release of that picture. In case of Terminator 2, the breach of implied contract claim expired per the statute of limitations 2 years after that motion picture was first released. With respect to Terminator 3, same analysis. And with respect to Terminator 4, the picture which he's now claiming somehow creates a new claim because a piece of material was removed from the film, a claim which candidly I don't even understand. But even if I did understand it, the breach of implied contract claim would have run and expired 2 years after the initial release of that film. That's expressly in the decisions that Judge White made.
And those decisions were appealed to us?
That's correct.
And we affirmed?
In effect, the dismissal was, the appeal was dismissed because they didn't do procedurally what they were supposed to.
But in effect, we affirmed.
That's correct. I mean, this is now the third lawsuit that's been brought by this plaintiff asserting these claims. Thank you. I appreciate it.
thank you, Pastor, for your time.
Thank you.
The case of Goldberg versus Cameron and Heard will be submitted. And we'll go to the next case on the calendar, which is Petrini versus Berrien.